Saturday morning at Preparedness Expo 93. We're so glad to have you here after a thunderstorm last night and a beautiful day today. And you have in store a treat. Don McAlvany in just a few moments will be lecturing. But today is your last day at this expo to get in person audio or videotapes of all of the speakers. By all means, I trust that you will. Keep in mind, of course, that you can save 20% over the cost of the audio tapes by buying the set of all of the speakers for Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Videotapes are available right on the spot, professionally being produced, and they can be sent to you in coming days. I'm sure you're going to want to remember this material in the future. And with all the material that Don McAlvany is going to give in the next hour and 30 minutes, there's no way I can keep it in my head, but I sure can remember it 6 months from now on the audio tape or the videotape. Please get your complimentary copy of Preparedness Journal. I understand that today is the last day that the special offer will be made for getting a subscription and a free audio tape to with Preparedness Journal subscription. So pick up your complimentary copy and by all means get the audio and video tapes for the entire sets. I hope you will. It's a real privilege to introduce Don McAlvany, author of Toward a New World Order, editor of the McAlvany Intelligence Advisory, and what I consider to be one of the most informed men in the world today in his particular field. Let's give a hand of applause to Don McAlvany, if you will.
Thank you, Lindsay. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to be speaking with you this morning about the Fourth Reich toward an American police state. I want to discuss with you some things that are going to be relatively heavy, things having to do with government encroachments on virtually every aspect of our lives. We're going to talk about the political decline of America, maybe a few things we can do about it, and maybe a few things we can do to get out of harm's way. In the last couple of days, I've put my perspective triangle up. When we've talked about the monetary economic decline of the United States and the fact that we could be on the verge of some tremendous convulsions economically. I analyzed that in detail yesterday and won't touch on that this morning. We've talked a little bit about the social political decline of America and the fact that we are plunging towards socialism. This is now accelerated since Bill and Hillary have come on the scene. Along with Al Gore and their entourage of socialists, and we are plunging towards the New World Order. We've talked about that in some detail. I'll run through that again very quickly this morning. I want to talk to you about a number of the things the government, the new rules and regulations and laws and seizures and forfeitures that the government is perpetrating against us, because I think you need to understand these things. I think you need to be prepared to defend yourself, your assets, and so forth against some of these encroachments. We are also looking at a spiritual decline in America as we have wandered away from our spiritual foundations, from our biblical Christ-centered foundations, and have accepted a secular humanist model that says we really don't need God, we can do it all ourselves. After all, we have high technology, we have all of our brilliance, et cetera, et cetera. And that has begotten a tremendous moral decline. And in many ways, in fact, in all of these areas, I believe America today is in a tremendous free fall. I think as we talk about the plunge towards socialism this morning, you can't separate it from the push that is on to push us into a new world order. George Bush talked about new world order several hundred times during his administration. Mikhail Gorbachev also talked about it, how they we would all cooperate to build this new world. The new world order is a world government which they've assured us they can deliver by the year 2000, the dawning of the age of Aquarius. That's only 7 years away. It's a world government that Fidel Castro recommended at the United Nations back in 1979. Gorbachev and the communists are pushing hard for it, as well as what I call the liberal Eastern establishment in the United States, which would be epitomized by groups like the Trilateral Commission, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Bilderbergers and the Club of Rome in Europe, and the Rockefellers, the Kissingers, et cetera, et cetera. What is this new world order? It simply is a world government under the United Nations that envisions a one world currency, a one world central bank, leading eventually to a total cashless society. It envisions One world population control, one world environmental control, one world economic planning, and all of it is to be held together by what they call the New World Army, which is a United Nations army that, for starters, will have 100,000 troops and will, in short order, move to probably 250,000 troops represented from all over the world. Some of these troops are actually being trained in the United States today, and there are indications that there is a move afoot to try to move more of these UN troops into the United States. So it's this UN New World Army, as the New York Times refers to it, that is to keep this whole thing together. Now, it's important to note that communism is not really gone, as they've told us. In fact, Russia is not as weak as we are told. Russia is weak. She has her problems, but she never dismantled her military. She never dismantled the KGB. As we unilaterally disarm, first under Bush and now under Clinton, the Russians continue to build record numbers of new submarines, jet aircraft, missiles, fighter planes, bombers, and so forth. The KGB is bigger today after two reorganizations in the last 24 months. It's bigger today than it was 2 years or 5 years ago. And so the communists have been laying low. They have followed the entreaty of Lenin, who said, we will advance through retreat. They still control a third of the world's landmass, about a third of the world's population. The Republic of South Africa is about to fall under communism to a communist revolution. We are seeing a similar revolution in the Philippines. Unfortunately, we have to look forward to an expansion of communism in Central America, as the Sandinistas now have total control of Nicaragua and should be shortly expanding into other countries in Central America. Nevertheless, the New World Order crowds say that the cornerstone of the New World Order is the merger of the common interests of the United States and the Soviet Union. So we see Newsweek talking about super partners, an ambitious game plan for a new era, the emerging U.S.-Soviet alliance. So we're pumping literally hundreds of billions of dollars into that country over a several-year period, food aid, high-tech aid, et cetera, et cetera. We, Germany, all of the Western world. We love the Russians in some part of the country. In Juneau, Alaska, they fly the Soviet flag over McDonald's. You'll find the Soviet or Russian flag flying in many parts of Alaska today. Our government issued stamps with the American and Russian astronauts reaching out to touch someone in outer space. I think that's what the, isn't that what the AT&T telephone ad says? This map is far from accurate, Archer Daniels Midland says in an advertisement. They're one of the multinational companies that profit from strong interest in the Soviet Union. This map is far from accurate, but it does sort of illustrate a very important point. As trade between the USSR and the U.S. expands, we're growing closer and closer together. Okay, and that's the whole idea, is to push us closer and closer together. The New World Order envisions three major regional governments. One is in Western Europe. It's the United States of Western Europe, and this regional government is made up of the various nations that were in the European Economic Community. It became a political union on December 31st, 1992. You'll see these posters in Europe, a picture of the Tower of Babel with upside-down stars on them. Those are actually Baphomets. They're occultic or satanic symbols. And basically what we have is the United States of Western Europe is run from Brussels, Belgium, by European socialists who are also occultists, long since infiltrated by the KGB. The second regional government is to be NACOM, the North American Common Market, the United States, Canada, and Mexico. The North American Free Trade Agreement, which Bush and now Clinton are pushing, is designed to kind of merge us economically like the European Economic Community, and within a very few years they hope to eliminate the borders between the United States, Canada, and Mexico, and have the second major regional government. The third will be out in the Pacific Rim, headquartered in Tokyo. They envision a regional government situation where there will be 10 regional governments which will supplant state governments. That would probably be impossible to install until they get a new constitution. And the idea is that if they can get the constitutional convention called CONCON, is not to worry so much about balanced budget amendment, which will be the excuse, but rather to try to push through a new constitution. If they're not able to accomplish that under Clinton, the establishment has already selected the next president. The next president of the United States has already been designated. His name is Ross Perot. Ross Perot is as much owned and as part of the establishment as is Bill Clinton and George Bush. He has the proper Rockefeller connections. He was nominated for membership to the Council on Foreign Relations by George Bush. Ross Perot is massively pro-abortion, pro-gun control, pro-big government, but he also is for supplanting the U.S. Constitution. So the New World Order crowd needs to nail the Constitution. Here's John Anderson, who ran for president as an independent back in 1980. He asked your support for a U.N. World Federation. World peace requires world laws. Global problems require global governments. Governance. Join John Anderson now in working to transform the United Nations into an empowered democratic world federation with a global parliament to enact laws to protect the Earth's environment, a standing peacekeeping force and arbitral system to prevent wars, an international criminal court to bring terrorists to trial, and by the new definitions which are emerging, I think many of us are going to be defined as terrorists. Watch the environmental movement. They had their big clam bake down in Rio last summer, the so-called Earth Summit. This was spearheaded by a man named Maurice Strong, who is the leading New Ager in the world and is also a high official in the United Nations, a powerful New World Order type. You had George Bush down at the Earth Summit. You had Al Gore lead the U.S. delegation. And it was ostensibly to bring about a clean earth, an environmental, global environmentalism, a global environmental protection agency. But in reality, they basically wrote a new world constitution. That's what the whole environmental movement is about, is to push us into socialism and towards the new world order. If you're a hardcore environmentalist, then you probably worship Mother Gaia. Mother Gaia is the so-called goddess of the planet Earth. I think probably she, in fact, is a demon. But you'll find tremendous occultic connections in this whole group that's pushing for the new world order. Bush talks about a new age of promise. You will find the leading New Agers, and by the way, the New Age movement also says world government by the year 2000. The leading New Agers are also the leading people in the New World Order crowd. So what we're looking at is not just a political move, but a supernatural move, which is to culminate in world government by the year 2000. The New Agers are very clear that there's a lot of people who give off the wrong vibes and the wrong waves, and they will have to be eliminated, and I think they include most of the Christians and Orthodox Jews in the world. And I do believe that all of this is setting the stage for the persecution of Christians in America. You saw just an early warning shot over the bow, if you will, with the government burning of all the people down in Waco, Texas, just a few weeks ago. By the way, Time magazine is talking about Janet Reno and saying that Janet Reno is a tremendous folk hero now, and as her popularity is soaring in Washington because of how courageous she was in burning to death those men, women, and children down there. So it's funny how Americans are beginning to react to a lot of things. So welcome to the Global Village. It's supposed to really be great. I think it's not going to be so great for people who love our Constitution, our traditional way of life, who love the Bible, who love the Lord Jesus Christ. I think it's going to get pretty rugged indeed. Let's review real quickly. I talked about this on Thursday night, but let's reveal real quickly who and what the Clinton administration really is. Your worst nightmare, the reality of the Clinton co-presidency. These two people rule our country today. The one on the right, Hillary Clinton, is the most powerful woman in the history of the United States. I think she will be seen to be, over the next year or two, the most evil and wicked woman in the history of the United States. But she has tremendous power today. But we need to remember, Bill and Hillary are actually low-ranking employees of the liberal Eastern establishment, as expendable as Jimmy Carter or George Bush were when the establishment had used them up. The establishment agenda for Bill and Hillary and Al are the homosexualization of America, vastly expanded abortion rights, both domestically and internationally. And you saw the president move on the third day of his presidency with five executive orders that expanded homosexual rights, abortion rights. The agenda includes vastly expanded government regulations and controls over every aspect of our lives. Expansion of environmental controls is a vehicle for the socialization of America. And if you want to understand part of the plan, then read Al Gore's book. It's a New Age book, but it's Earth in the Balance, Ecology and the Human Spirit, and you'll get some idea as to what they have in mind. Okay? Their agenda includes the expansion of the size and power and influence of the United Nations and its UN World Army, the disarming of the American people via gun control. Gun control is what Waco was all about. It was to be a big propaganda exercise against people who had guns. It kind of went astray. It backfired on them. But massive push coming for gun control. The BATF, I think, will not only not go out of business, but will emerge even more powerful than before. And they are shutting down people and shutting down gun dealers. I know of one gun manufacturer here in the state of Utah who was arrested, and everything, all of his manufacturing was confiscated just this past Monday. And so you can expect an acceleration of the gun control efforts, okay? A sharp increase in taxes for middle and upper income Americans and businesses. By the way, if you're concerned about guns and gun ownership, you ought to go out and visit Booth 519. 519, that's Gun Owners of America. They're not as big as the National Rifle Association, but they are really hardcore. They're run by a friend of mine named Larry Pratt. They do tremendous work on trying to stop this BATF juggernaut. They are trying to produce a film dealing with the BATF massacre of all these people down in Waco, Texas, and you need to support Gun Owners of America, an excellent, excellent organization which is doing tremendous work in trying to keep our constitutional right guaranteed by the Second Amendment to own and bear firearms. So go out and see the Gun Owners of America. You may want to sign up. You certainly want to get their information and so forth. That's Booth 519. We'll see a sharp increase in taxes for the middle and upper income Americans and businesses. I discussed this yesterday, but basically the Clinton tax plan will include $377 billion in new taxes. That doesn't include paying for Hillary's socialized medicine program, which will be another $90 billion for starters. So we're looking at the biggest increase in taxes in U.S. history. The biggest producers within a couple of years are going to be paying somewhere between 50 and 60% of their total income in taxes, and that is certainly going to strangle the economy, cut back on their producing, et cetera, et cetera. The agenda includes establishment of a socialized medicine program. Hillary has been made the czar over that, and it will destroy what's left of our medical system. We'll look more like Sweden or Eastern Germany, a few years ago than the America of our day. So I strongly recommend you learn how to become self-sufficient medically. You begin to learn about herbal medicine, about detoxification, about homeopathics and things of that nature, so that you can keep your family healthy in the unstable period that lies ahead. The establishment agenda for the Clintonistas includes the sodomization and the disarmament and dismantling of the U.S. military, the delivery of South Africa to the ANC, the African National Congress. They've been working on that for 15 years. They could achieve that within 6 to 12 months, maybe less. And Nicaragua back in the hands of the Sandinistas. Remember, it was the Carter people that brought the Sandinistas to power, that brought Khomeini to power, and those same Carter foreign policy people are now back in the saddle. Rapprochement with Cuba is part of it. And as I said, the leftist lineup of the Clinton administration includes most of the top echelon of our members of the Council on Foreign Relations or the Trilateral Commission. Top 35 members of the administration, including the entire cabinet, belong to either the Council on Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission, the Leftist Institute for Economics, the Leftist Institute for Policy Studies, the Leftist Service Legal Services Corporation, or are part of the Harvard, Yale, Princeton elite, or some combination of these. The administration has been staffed with Carter-era foreign policy leftists, socialists, disarmament freaks, women's libbers, homosexuals, radical abortionists, and environmentalists. I said this would be our worst nightmare, and I believe it will. The new Clinton administration is far and away the most left-wing administration in U.S. history. There were 15 open homosexuals on the Clinton transition team and three or four homosexuals in the cabinet, most of them selected by Hillary. Hillary will be in charge of staffing the most of the new judge appointments to the judiciary. There'll be 175 to 200 new federal judges. Hillary will select most of them. And since she is a flaming leftist and a flaming pro-homosexual, you can assume that many of these people will have the same sentiment, all of them. She'll also be responsible for the selection of 3 to 4 Supreme Court justices. The replacement for Byron Wizard White will be the first one. Clinton's coordinator for education, arts, labor, and humanities is Jeanetta Cole, an active long-term supporter of Fidel Castro, a member of the Communist Front, the Venceslaus Brigade, and its subfront, the Committee to Stop U.S. Aggression Against Cuba. Members of those groups were trained by the Cuban DGI, or Cuban intelligence. Okay. As I said, they are bringing back the Carter-era foreign policy team. America now has the most dangerous foreign and domestic policy team in the history of the United States. A quick look at Hillary. Hillary Rodham Clinton is the co-president of the United States. She may emerge with more power than her husband. Interesting parallel in the book of 1 Kings between King Ahab and Jezebel. Jezebel was a witch, not a nice person, and responsible for the death of many, many believers. And she really ran her husband and ran Israel at that time. And the parallel between Ahab and Jezebel and these people is really pretty incredible. Watch Hillary very carefully. Hillary says that she talks to Eleanor Roosevelt every week. Hillary has some very strong occultic leanings. She's very much into shamanism, which is a form of witchcraft practiced by the Indians and people in the ancient world. Very, very much into that. Hillary is a radical leftist, a radical feminist lawyer, the most powerful and most dangerous woman in the history of the United States. Hillary is the major mover and shaker behind Bill's radical pro-abortion, pro-homosexual initiatives, and the appointment of 15 homosexuals to the transition team and 3 to 4 to the cabinet. Many of the key appointments in the administration have been made by Hillary and her radical leftist and lesbian friends of the First Lady. Okay, I won't go into who some of those are, but if you look close, I think you'll be able to probably spot them. Okay? Hillary knows all about Bill's numerous extramarital affairs and is in a position to blackmail him if he doesn't give her major power in the administration. All she has to do is say, Bill, I'm going to call a press conference and I'm going to tell the world who and what you're really all about as far as his extracurricular sexual affairs and so forth, and Bill's going to give her whatever she wants. Hillary and Bill hate one another and curse at each other constantly. I have friends who are in the Secret Service who tell me you wouldn't believe the things they throw at one another, the things that they are bizarre. They use the worst of language, the worst of the four-letter words at one another, and yet the press portrays them as a happy, loving, typical American couple. Wrong. Okay? Hillary's payoff for her support of Bill was to be made czar over the installation of the socialized medicine in America. Her power and influence may grow beyond Bill's over the next year or so. Okay? So much for the complexion, if you will, of the Clinton administration. Now let's quickly look at some of the present parallels between the United States and Nazi Germany. First of all, we need to understand the political spectrum. On the far right of the political spectrum is anarchists. Okay, they believe in abolishing all government, running wild and woolly in the streets. Okay, libertarianism is somewhere over on the right, and they believe that you limit almost most of the powers of the government, and they do have some good ideas. In the middle, where we were originally founded as a country, we were founded as a constitutional republic, right in the middle of the political spectrum. Okay, Washington, Jefferson, and most political conservatives today who still believe in the Constitution and our traditional values would be in the middle of the political spectrum. On the far left, of course, is communism. But also on the far left is National Socialism, which is Nazism, okay? They've tried to redefine it as being right-wing, but that's not true. Nazism is socialism, and it's on the far left, as is fascism, as is socialism, as is liberalism, as is secular humanism, okay? Now, the liberals have come along to confuse the issue, and they've said, no, because communism is on the far left, the people who oppose communism are on the far right, and so they take and they put the Nazis over on the far right, but they weren't. The Nazis were far left. Study Mein Kampf, which was the writings of Adolf Hitler, and compare it with Das Kapital and the Communist Manifesto. Very, very similar. Okay, and then they say, but if the Nazis are over on the far right, then so are the conservatives, and so they have relabeled us as right wing extremists, et cetera, et cetera. And that's a favorite tactic of the political left, is to take their opposition and to label them with horrible, nasty names. People who are patriots today are being called right-wing fanatics. They're being called religious fanatics, dangerous religious cultists, white supremacists, Nazis, etc., etc. And this is setting the stage for a government attack against conservatives, against traditionalists, against people who believe in the Constitution, against strong Christians, etc., etc. They've already begun to declare that strong Christians who believe in homeschooling, who believe in disciplining their children, who study the Bible, who believe in the second coming of Christ and in Bible prophecy and so forth, the establishment press in the last 60 days has already begun to describe us as dangerous religious cultists. And we know what we do with dangerous religious cultists, don't we? We burn them. Okay? Look at Waco. Okay, there's some common denominators behind the Nazis, the fascists, and the communists. The common denominators are they're an all-powerful totalitarian dictatorial government which control all aspects of their subjects' lives. These three forms of government promulgate massive numbers of rules, regulations, and laws enforced by an all-powerful bureaucracy and a preoccupation with death. They have a tremendous preoccupation with death. My associate, Dave Sally, is passing out some tablets. If you'd like to get on our mailing list or would like to be notified when I'm speaking in your area, please sign that tablet and move it along, if you would. You still have to buy the newsletter. I can't give that away, but other things that we send out from time to time, we can send you. Okay, all three, Nazism, fascism, and communism, are based on man's reason and a rejection of God, his authority, and his law. Socialism, which America is presently plunging into, is simply communism or Nazism minus the dictatorship, or gulag, as in Sweden in recent decades. Socialism is simply a small step away from communism or Nazism. As the head of the Labour Socialist Party in England said some years ago, his name was John Strachey, he said, it's impossible to move directly from communism to capitalism. You've got to use socialism as a stepping stone or an interim step, so all communists should work for socialism. Lenin, Stalin, Hitler, Mussolini, Gorbachev, Castro, Daniel Ortega, all of these are primarily, first and foremost, socialists, and so are Bill and Hillary Clinton. Okay? Most people condemn Nazism because of its overt, gross manifestations, the Holocaust, the extermination of millions of Jews and others, the death and destruction of World War II, instead of because of Nazism's essence. Nazism was much more than killing Jews and starting wars. It was rejection of God, his authority, and of his law. Now, there's some interesting present parallels between the U.S. and the Nazi Third Reich. In Nazi Germany, there was a tremendous preoccupation with death. Abortion became very commonplace in Germany in the late 20s and 30s, and per capita they were doing more of it than we are in this country, although 40% of all pregnancies in America are now ended by killing the baby. Okay, in America today. From abortion, the Germans went on to euthanasia, and from euthanasia, then they went on to emptying out the homes that had the infirm, the old, the aged, the crippled, people who were blind, and they began to kill them. And really, before they ever got to the place where they were killing Jews in concentration camps and so forth, and before they launched World War II, they had emptied out these homes and killed around 274,000. Okay, now, so there was a tremendous preoccupation with death in Nazi Germany. And, of course, we see the explosion in abortion in this country. We're moving towards euthanasia. The average American, you know, didn't even blink when the government killed those 100 or so people down in Waco. Didn't even blink. Well, we see 20,000 murders from the time a kid is probably 3 years old until he's grown on television, and so we're inoculated to violence. We don't even think a thing about it. And it's amazing, as I've been on dozens of talk shows since Operation Waco, since the government torched that place, and the average American, the average Christian says, well, those guys were radical cultists and they had guns, they deserved what they got. Okay? We're beginning to move towards the same mental, psychological preoccupation with death in this country that they had, and that led to the extermination of a lot of Christians and a lot of people before it was all over in Germany. There were thousands of laws, rules, and regulations passed in Germany that basically made everybody in Germany a criminal. You couldn't keep track of all of them, you couldn't keep up with them, so they could nail anybody they wanted to nail at any time for these various laws, rules, and regulations. They begin to nail Christians for sending money out of the country to missionaries under the new monetary economic laws, et cetera, et cetera. We're seeing exactly the same thing in America with tens of thousands of new rules, laws, and regulations that make all of us criminals, and I'll talk more about that in just a few minutes. Okay, there was an occultic dimension. Very much an occultic dimension to the Third Reich. People think it was primarily political. It was primarily supernatural. These people were Satan worshippers. They got involved in some Eastern religions that were the same religions that were the basis of the New Age movement. And so the Third Reich was primarily occultic. Okay, and when you see the rise of the occult, you will always see it turn against fundamental Christians and against Orthodox Jews. And it did in Germany, and you'll see the same thing happen here in the United States in the very, very near future. But you need to understand that this whole move towards the New World Order and the New Age, which are opposite sides of the same coin, is primarily occultic. and there is a supernatural, satanic dynamic behind it. The people who are the leading lights in the New World Order in this crowd, in this country, are also worshipers of Lucifer, son of the morning star. Okay? So another similarity between us and Nazi Germany then was the occultic dimension of the Third Reich. They had a tremendous preoccupation with animal rights. The same Nazis that could kill Jews, that could kill anybody, crippled children, Christians, you name it, those same Nazis would become emotional and would weep over the death of an animal, a wild animal, a farm animal. They finally curtailed hunting. They stopped the killing of farm animals. The top Nazis all became vegetarians. They would weep over the boiling of a frog or a lobster. And these were the same people who didn't even give a second thought to the killing of people, to the killing of babies and the old people and euthanasia, et cetera, et cetera. And you say, well, what an incredible inconsistency that you would love and weep over animals and not think anything about the death of people. We have the same inconsistency in the United States today. The same people who will weep over the spotted owl or a whale or a snail darter or a wolf. Or whatever, who are freaks on animal rights, who are the environmentalists, who are the earth firsters in this country. These are the same people who are the leaders in killing babies and moving to euthanasia, et cetera, et cetera. And it's hard to understand that what appears to be a gross inconsistency if you don't understand the occultic nature of our environmental movement in this country today and the occultic nature of this whole animal rights movement in Nazi Germany a few years ago. They ignored their constitution. They had a very fine constitution in that country. They totally ignored it. In fact, Hitler just would write notes to the doctors. He wrote a little note on a scrap of paper to the leading doctor and said, okay, now we're going to start killing the old people. We're going to start euthanasia on the old people. And they started doing things that were totally extra-constitutional. They ran roughshod over the constitution. That's exactly what our government is doing. They pretend like the constitution's not there. Just exactly how was the constitution followed when the BATF attacked those folks down in Waco on the 27th of February with 100 people? How do you serve due process and serve a search warrant, as our Constitution says you're supposed to do, when you attack a place with 100 people and helicopter gunships and throwing stun grenades in and go through the windows with your guns blazing, et cetera, et cetera? When Slick Willie wrote his five executive orders on the third day he was in office, how did this fit in with the Constitution or any of the other thousands of executive orders? So you see, we're ignoring our Constitution just like they were. Rejected their heritage. They had a fine heritage. They had a Christian heritage. Remember Martin Luther, who was head of the Christian Reformation, came from Germany, and yet they totally ran roughshod over their heritage and forgot it. They wiped out their history, just like George Orwell in 1984 said Big Brother would do, erase the old history and create a new history, a socialist history, and that's exactly what's happening in our country today as we reject our heritage. Hitler used homosexuals, drug addicts, and criminals to destabilize the country and advance the Nazi political machine. Now, he used them for about a year. He organized these folks into something called the Brown Shirts. But they were creating so much havoc that finally the military and the SS, the Gestapo, came to him on June 30th of 1934, and they said, you get rid of these idiots, these scum that are helping to destabilize this country, or we will withdraw our support. And so on June 30th of 1934, they had what was called the Night of the Long Knives, and they began to kill thousands of these homosexuals and these drug addicts and these gangsters and so forth, and they eventually wiped most of them out. Watch Bill and Hillary and how they are using homosexuals today. And it is also beginning to be rumored that the government may be organizing gangs in Los Angeles and elsewhere to be kind of the shock troops as they move this whole New World Order thing along. And so that'll be interesting to see if our government does something similar. But at least the Clintonistas are now using the homosexuals much in the way that Hitler did when he first came to power. So there's some very, very interesting parallels today for people who will look at what was happening in Nazi Germany in the early 1930s. And I want to remind you that when the Nazis came to power, they were voted into power, and within 12 months they had established a total dictatorship. The people supported most of this. The mentality of the people had been prepared in the 20s and early 30s for the Nazi takeover, just as I think the mentality of the American people in the 70s and 80s and in the early 90s is being prepared for something very, very similar in the United States today. Let's talk about the Fourth Reich toward an American police state. America, as I said, is beginning to look more and more like Nazi Germany of the early 30s or the Soviet Union from the 20s through the 80s. True criminals, murderers, rapists, burglars, robbers, etc., are giving light or negligible jail sentences, while the government is now reclassifying honest, law-abiding Americans as criminals and giving them severe jail sentences or confiscating their assets or property via the draconian Nazi Marxist-Leninist-style seizure laws. The legal system and government now allows the have-nots to plunder the haves or the assets of the haves in America. And a gargantuan U.S. government passes tens of thousands of new regulations each year, 67,700 pages of fine print in 1992 to control every aspect of Americans' lives. As the U.S. is moving towards a socialist America and towards the New World Order, the strategy of Antonio Gramsci, founder of the Italian Communist Party, is being utilized. Gramsci believed the communists could not seize the political power until they first seized cultural power. Okay? So Gramsci said that the social revolution would be brought about by the transformation of a society's culture and values, not through political or military power. The establishment of radical socialism in a targeted country, his was Italy, now it's America, would come via the undermining and transformation of traditional Western values. Is that happening in America today? You watch television, you see the garbage on television and in the movies, you listen to the rock music, you see the abortion, you see the pornography our country is kicking out. The strategy of the socialist then is to change the way society thinks about problems to gain control over the minds of the population. Gramsci strategized the convergence of religion and socialism with religion stripped of all spiritual content and a takeover of the entire field where culture is manifest. That is in the schools, the universities, the media, the Hollywood, et cetera, et cetera. And that, of course, has happened. Following Gramsci's strategy, the socialists of our day in America, Europe, South Africa, and throughout the West have developed a superstructure reflecting a socialist culture, replete with socialist literature, films, plays, poetry, and various forms of art and music. And if your kids are in the public schools anywhere in America today, they're being brainwashed with same. Or if you watch television, you are being brainwashed with same. It should be remembered that Bill Clinton has studied under and highly praised Italian socialists and communists, and the people they have brought in with them fit very well into this Gramsci strategy. Okay, we're going to talk now about the effort, the thrust to control the people. We're going to look at the explosion of government regulations, the environmental regulations, how we're moving towards a national police force, the police state tactics that are emerging, how we're moving towards a state of national emergency and the electronic surveillance and computerization of the public. I've got about 3 hours of lecture, and I've got to finish this in 54 minutes and 34 seconds. So I've talked slow so far, and now I am about to speed up. And if you don't believe it, you watch and see. And I'm glad you still have a little bit of sense of humor left, because you're going to need it by the time I get through. Okay? People control is essential to any totalitarian state, whether it's Nazi Germany, the former Soviet Union, Cuba, and the socialist America of the 1990s, or in the emerging New World Order. The explosion of government regulations that we are witnessing today is absolutely incredible. Congress passed almost 2,500 new laws in 1992. Most of these new laws carry both criminal and civil penalties for violations. To implement these new laws, tens of thousands of new regulations were written by over 100,000 government bureaucrats, probably closer to 200,000, who were part of dozens of huge government agencies, the IRS, the SEC, the ATF, you remember their fame down in Waco, FDA, EPA, OSHA, HUD, FBI, etc. These new regulations, many of which carry criminal penalties, filled 67,700 pages of the Federal Register in fine print in 1992. You are responsible for following every one of those regulations on pain of fines, asset forfeiture, or imprisonment for violation. Ignorance of the law in America is no longer an excuse. You have been legally advised via the Federal Register and are assumed to have read it. Like when you put a legal notice in the paper, I'm no longer responsible for my wife's debts or whatever. You see those in the paper all the time. That's considered a legal notice whether you saw it or not. And the Federal Register is considered legal notice. You can't read it and understand it. It would take a battery of Philadelphia lawyers to read and understand all of these regulations. But you're responsible for every one. And when you violate one, you are now a criminal. Okay? We spend $600 billion on government regulations each year. And if you were to eliminate these regulatory agencies and these regulations, you would certainly balance the budget, and America's financial crisis would come to a quick halt. They will not be eliminated. They will be expanded under the Clintonistas. Incredibly, the government has created a situation in which you are almost certain to be a criminal. You are breaking one or more of these regulations right now and don't even know it, and that's exactly the way they did it in Nazi Germany in 1933, 35, 37, and so on. Let's look at the environmental regulations. The Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, and a host of other environmental laws and regulations passed in recent years give the government draconian dictatorial controls over virtually every business and person, over every piece of private property, every car, and every action of every American in the U.S. today. Okay? Environmental laws and regulations, both domestic and international, will be the primary vehicle for moving us into socialism and into the New World Order. 70% of private property in America today is already considered by the government to be wetlands, whether there is surface water on it or not, and therefore under their control, and the environmentalists are pushing to make that 100%. Okay? Thousands of U.S. citizens or businesses each year are being fined, having their property seized or jailed for wetlands violations. Let's give you a couple of examples. There was a Hungarian refugee named Pozgai that came to this country back about 15 years ago. He was fleeing communist tyranny, and he was seeking freedom, the land of the free, the home of the brave. He went to Pennsylvania. He set up an auto repair business. He worked hard. He paid it off. No debt. Was very successful. And about 2.5 years ago, Pozgai decided he would expand his auto repair business. He bought the adjacent land next door. He began to clear out some old rubbish that was on there, some old tires. He brought in some fill dirt. And he was about halfway through his expansion project when agents from the Environmental Protection Agency came in. And they said, "Mr. Pozgai, you are in criminal violation of the Wetlands Act. This is a wetland. The Clean Water Act says that you have to get all these forms and fill out and pay these fees and get our permission to do this, that, and the other." And he had been hauling some fill dirt in, and they said that's a criminal violation. He thought they were pulling his chain. He literally thought he had gotten away from that kind of bureaucracy and tyranny when he left communist Hungary. Little did he know. In any case, he said, "Fine, I'll pay the fees, I'll pay the fines. What do I do? Where are the forms to fill out?" They said, "You don't understand. We're going to indict you for criminal violation of the Clean Water Act." And they did indict Pozgai, and they found him guilty on 5 counts of violation. They fined him $200,000. They seized his auto repair business and all of his property, and they sentenced him to 3 years in the federal penitentiary where Pozgai now sits. His crime was hauling fill dirt in on his own property. He should have stayed in communist Hungary, which in some ways today is freer than the United States of America. Take the case of Bill Ellen. Bill Ellen was an environmentalist himself. He lived over in the state of Maryland. This was talked about on 2020, by the way, on CBS. And Bill Ellen knew the environment. He believed in the environment. He was working with the wealthy landowner over on the shores of Chesapeake Bay, and they were going to build a big bird sanctuary. Okay, and so they had several thousand acres, and they were going to build some waterways and things and some lakes and ponds for these birds. He went through the Environmental Protection Agency, and he filled out all the right forms, at least as the law stood in, I think, 1988. But in 1989, they changed the law, and they said that potholes now represent a wetland. Okay, a wetland could be out in the desert in Nevada. It can have subsurface water. Anything they want to call a wetland, they can call and therefore say we have now control over that land. Okay, remember, property rights are the most important rights of all guaranteed by the U.S. Constitution. If they can take your property rights, they can take all of your civil rights, and this is exactly what's happening. So anyway, Bill Ellen checked with some Environmental Protection Agency people, and they told him, "Yeah, go ahead with this," but then some other ones came along and said, "No, you can't, there's new regulations," and he followed the advice of the first ones, and they hauled in some fill dirt, and so there was a rainstorm, and several EPA agents came out and said, "See those potholes? They filled up with water. You are in criminal violation. You are desecrating a wetland because there were some piles of fill dirt." And so they took him to court and they threw him in jail. Okay? The owner of the land was fined $1 million and was forced to give $1 million to the National Wildlife Federation in order to avoid going to jail. If you think those are isolated examples, I will tell you they are happening to thousands and thousands of people all over the country today. In fact, for violation of the Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act, they have a maximum penalty of up to 400 years in jail. Better that you go out and shoot the President of the United States or shoot someone, and I'm not recommending that for people on the videotape. I'm not recommending it. But you can commit murder in broad daylight today and get a lesser sentence than if you are guilty of some of these environmental crimes, okay? Really scary type stuff. Okay, I want to repeat for the sake of the video, I'm not recommending you go out and shoot someone. I simply was making a point. Okay, so thousands of U.S. citizens and businesses are having their assets seized because of violations of the environmental laws. Let's see about the move towards a national police force. The socialists believe in crisis management to solve crises, real or manufactured, in order to greatly expand their power and control over the people. So they create these crises. The war on drugs, the environmental crisis, the war on crime, discrimination against minorities, hate crimes, firearms violations, etc., are all crises which supposedly justify the passage and enforcement of new laws and regulations, expansion of bureaucratic agencies, and the installation of police state power over the people. The newest crisis is the crisis of child abuse. And you're hearing more and more about this in the press. And so if they can accuse you of child abuse, maybe you leave your children at home alone while you go shopping. That can be called child abuse. Maybe you refuse to teach them about homosexual lifestyles. Soon that will be child abuse. If you don't get your children the forced inoculations that Bill, Hillary, Donna Shalala, and Teddy Kennedy are pushing, that will be considered criminal child abuse. Bill Clinton and Al Gore, in their book, Putting People First, called for a national police force of up to 100,000 police. Okay, that's the book. It's a nauseating little book, but they do lay out some of their plan for the socialization of America, so it may be worth getting just so you can kind of know what they're up to. Okay, this national police force will be made up of retired military personnel, other government employees, former police, et cetera, et cetera, and ostensibly is to fight the crime war and America's other crises. Clinton's new economic plan calls for the launching of this national police force very, very soon. How will it differ from the Gestapo? Look at Waco and you answer that for yourself. Outgoing CIA Director Robert Gates has called for the CIA to be given the power to spy on American businesses and individuals and to help support the Justice Department and other federal agencies in enforcing the myriad of new government laws, rules, and regulations. If the criminal enforcement agents of the DEA, the FBI, the CIA, the BATF, the EPA, the FDA, the IRS, and other government agencies and departments are included, the U.S. could soon have a national police force of 200,000 to 300,000 people spying on the public and enforcing regulations, shades of the Gestapo in Nazi Germany or the KGB in Russia. The New World Order crowd are also talking about an international police force made up of U.N. troops from member countries to control internal crises. Internal crises, not just external crises, environmental abuses, and eventually opponents of the New World Order. And some of those troops are being trained in America, and there is growing concern that under UN Resolution 43, which Les Aspin, who is the head of the Defense Department, and Warren Christopher, who is the new head of the State Department, say they want to implement very rapidly, and UN Resolution 43 does call for more UN troops on our soil. Okay? The New World Army, or the UN police force, will soon reach 100,000 and could grow to 250,000 or more over the next 5 years. An undisclosed number of UN troops are now training on U.S. soil and could be used in America in some future state of national emergency, civil unrest, such as the Los Angeles riots or other upheaval. Let's look at some of the police state tactics which we're now having to live with. U.S. military and National Guard personnel have been undergoing training and exercises for several years for house-to-house searches, presumably for drugs or guns, for crowd control, and for domestic counterterrorism measures. Roadblocks are being randomly set up on highways around America by local, state, federal officials to conduct driver's license checks or warrantless spot checks of cars or their occupants for drugs, liquor, or especially for firearms. Local, state, or military helicopters are of greatly increased frequency overflying cities, towns, neighborhoods, and individual houses at low levels looking for drugs, for surveillance, or for intimidation purposes. Many of these helicopters are black and unmarked. They're overflowing major metro areas all over the country today. Over the past 2 years, as training and enforcement exercises have increased, SWAT teams in black ninja suits and other government marshals and enforcement teams have had an increasing number of shootouts with innocent victims who are characterized by the government as religious fundamentalists, as cultists, as white supremacists, as left or right-wing extremists, as tax protesters, as gun law violators, etc. I think you all know the case of Randy Weaver, where the government came up because of a supposed firearms violation. A shotgun he sold was supposed to be a quarter of an inch too thick. And they came up last August and they shot his son, and then they ultimately with the sniper shot his wife. He's on trial right now in southern Idaho. You might pray for the man. He's hopefully he'll win in that trial. In any case, they came into the home of Donald Scott, who was a wealthy businessman in Southern California near Malibu. A SWAT team of about 30 broke into his home one night. The guy reached for a gun. They told him to put it down. He reached to lay it on the ground, and they shot him dead. And it appears that they wanted his property. And see, they can come in and they can seize your property if they find any marijuana on it. Let's say you've got a teenage child, and he has a party, and one of his friends comes over, and they smoke grass in the backyard, and they leave a couple of pieces of grass in the backyard or something of marijuana. They can basically come in and confiscate your whole home, and you have no recourse, okay? So that's what they were trying to do to this guy, Donald Scott. They shot him. We'll talk more about what happened in Waco in a few minutes. The general tactic, whether used by local or federal state police officials, is to overwhelm and intimidate the suspected money launderer, environmental, financial criminal, gun law violator, etc. By invading his home or business with a SWAT team and or federal marshals or other government agents numbering 10 to 20 to 30 to 100, as in Waco, guns are often drawn, and if the victim of the attack makes any move, he is often shot. In fact, the police are told if they make any kind of unfriendly move whatsoever, shoot them. And in fact, if they shoot the victim, then they don't have to, you know, the police don't even have to have much explanation in court. Okay, nobody testifies against them. Okay, we're moving towards a state of national emergency. The dictionary defines martial law as a system of government under the direction of military authority, an arbitrary kind of law proceeding directly from military power, having no constitutional or legislative sanction. It supersedes all civil government. Okay? Martial law was imposed in Los Angeles and was begged for by the public to quell the massive riots in the spring of 92, and could have been declared nationally had the riots continued to spread during the summer of 92. In fact, the riots did spread to, I think, 166 cities. I think in some future period of riots, and one has to wonder who stirred up those riots. They were not spontaneous. There were definitely several communist groups involved. But I have friends who believe that this could have been a trial run by the establishment to see what was going on, to see how the people would respond. Would they call for martial law? They did. Kind of a test case, et cetera, et cetera. Suspension of the writ of habeas corpus is part of martial law. That's the right to trial by jury and protection from illegal imprisonment. This is a major element of martial law. In fact, indeed today in some parts of the country, people are being arrested for gun violations. They're being held in jail, and they're not even being charged. And that's totally unconstitutional, as is most of what we're talking about today. Potential for a state of national emergency or martial law in America in coming months or years is very high, perhaps to deal with the riots, the war on crime or drugs, to deal with dangerous, as they say, gun violations, a financial banking crisis, or some manufactured crisis. State of national emergency would be a quantum jump toward a socialist America and the New World Order. Hundreds of executive orders have been passed by Congress over the past few decades, giving the president total dictatorial control over every aspect of America's life when the president or his establishment bosses decide to trigger and implement a state of national emergency. Under a full state of emergency, tens or hundreds of thousands of Americans suspected of so-called hate crimes. A hate crime can be speaking out these days against a homosexual. I think very quickly speaking out against the government, as I'm doing now, will be relabeled as a hate crime. Financial or gun control crimes, criminal violation of any of tens of thousands of new government regulations, resistance to the New World Order or socialist America, all these are things for which people are likely to be imprisoned. It's my understanding that there are upwards to 47 concentration camps which have now been built around the United States. Some of these are called federal detention centers. Many of these are well disguised. You cannot overfly them. The FAA has special no-fly zones around the United States, and if you are in a small airplane and you fly over one, I suppose they won't shoot you down, but they will at least arrest you, and you may have some real problems when you get down. There are more and more, there's more and more information about these coming in all the time. Okay, perhaps this is why Bush more than doubled the prison capacity in the United States, and several dozen, as I said, upwards to four dozen, large federal detention centers still largely occupied have been built since 1984. I wonder who they're for. Okay? As the part of this whole trend of draconian gun control laws will be passed in 1993, watch the gun control legislation. If they have a constitutional convention, if they begin to collect the guns, and indeed they are beginning to collect the guns, several people were raided in southern Utah in just the last couple of days. One man I know who is a gun manufacturer is sitting in jail right now. They confiscated all of his equipment, et cetera, et cetera. This happened just in Utah just in the last couple of days. You're going to see more and more of this as they move us towards gun control. Before they can slam dunk a socialist America, a Nazi-type police state, or the New World Order on us, they must confiscate the guns. And so there will be tremendous intimidation. I believe there will be house-to-house searches looking for guns as well. Indeed, the National Guard has been training for several years for just such house-to-house searches. Ross Perot says if he were president, that's what he would do to get the guns. Let's talk about electronic surveillance and the computerization of the public. Computers and other high-tech breakthroughs over the past few years have given the U.S. and other governments the ability to listen to, monitor, track, and keep citizens under surveillance from the cradle to the grave that was not available to Hitler and Nazi Germany, or to the communists in Russia, China, or the East Bloc until very recently. Each adult American now has several dozen or more files and government data, computerized databases, all tied together and keyed to your Social Security number. Every one of you has a dossier that will probably exceed 100 pages, and that includes almost every American adult compiled by the government via computer records, et cetera, et cetera. They go to the credit bureaus. They look at what you've done through your bank records. They look at what you've done through your credit cards, et cetera, et cetera. Dozens of different government agencies maintain billions of records on the American public. I'm told that when they went in to take out the Randy Weaver family last summer, that the reason the sniper waited outside in order to shoot Mrs. Weaver was because they had done a computerized profile based on the government data they had on them and concluded she was the strong one in the family and therefore take her out and the whole thing would kind of fall apart. Computerized profiles on each adult American were assembled by the IRS between 1985 and 1990 using tax, credit card, bank, medical, employment, police, passport, and other records drawn from various government databases, private credit bureaus, et cetera, et cetera. Most phone calls, telexes, faxes, and certain U.S. mail are now regularly monitored by federal agencies. The U.S. government is presently purchasing hundreds of fax tapping machines at $30,000 per copy. If you have something private to say, don't say it on a telephone and don't say it on a fax. Phones can now be made hot on the hook, which means they can be turned into microphones even when hung up and not in use. They now have the technology, they got it from Sweden in the last 2 years, to be able to listen to phone conversations even when your phone is hung up. Adjust your conversations accordingly. According to a 1992 report by the General Accounting Office entitled FBI Advanced Communications Technologies Pose Wiretapping Challenges, is the intention of the FBI to tap every phone in America? I didn't say it. The Government Accounting Office, GAO, said that that's what the FBI is trying to do. The National Security Agency, NSA, has monitored international phone calls to or from the U.S. for years. Computerized voice recognition on phones picks up keywords from phone conversations which trigger the NSA tape recorders. Several years ago, U.S. passports were made computer readable. Now U.S., Canadian, Australian, German, and other European authorities are installing computers in airports which not only read passports but which also read handprints via infrared security readers. Data banks of computerized handprints will be developed over the next few years and linked to other government databases so that an instant computer record for an individual will be flashed on a screen simply by waving a person's hand over this infrared light, very much as they do with the barcoded products at the grocery store today. The system is presently being set up in the U.S. at the Kennedy and the Newark airports and is being set up at airports throughout Europe, I believe, some places in Canada, et cetera, et cetera. A national ID card is coming, replete with biometric identification systems, using fingerprints and handprints tied to government databases. And indeed, Donna Shalala, the Secretary of Health and Human Services, as part of her and Hillary's socialized medicine program, is calling for national ID cards, which all of us will have. And then just as in the Soviet East Bloc countries, you can have your papers, and when they want to check, you'll have to pull out your papers, which will include your ID card. It'll be a highly computerized type card. Cars can now be tracked via small computers implanted in them and receiving devices. They're putting computerized things in the highways. That's been in the press all over the country for the last 4 or 5 days, that they're computerizing the highways and so forth. So they plan to be able to track your automobile, where you are in your car at any given time. They'll link it up with satellite technology, et cetera, et cetera. In the next couple of years, you will begin to have these computerized devices in new cars. Won't that be fun? They've done a lot of the experimentation with that over in Singapore. They do a lot of the experiments for the New World Order in Singapore, by the way. The U.S. government has spent some $3 billion over the past 15 years to develop this system of vehicle people tracking, okay? And they're ready to now begin to implement it, and they've gone public with it. Sometimes they tell you what they're going to do to you before they do it, okay? Every square inch of the Earth's surface can now be monitored by satellites so that all persons and activities can now be watched. Lasers can be directed at a building from over a mile away. They really don't need to come into your house and bug it anymore. They can direct a laser at your building from a mile or so away, and they can listen to the conversation completely. And you really can't cover it up by turning up the radio or turning up the shower or whatever, because they know how to separate out those noises. High technology in the hands of despots or would-be dictators who wish to push us into a socialist America and a new world order will simply help them to lock on the chains that much more quickly and efficiently. Okay, let's talk about moving towards a cashless society and the war on cash and privacy. Very important that you know the new rules and regulations that are coming along, because they're jailing people and taking their assets by the thousands who violate these regulations. So you need to understand some of what I'm about to say. Socialists in America hate privacy and they hate cash because they make it much harder to control people. Anyone who is a staunch advocate of privacy or uses much cash is now considered by the government bureaucrats and law enforcement officials to be a criminal. If they're going to install a socialist America or the New World Order a la George Orwell's 1984, they must be able to track, monitor, and control every aspect of a person's life. Cash is trackless and difficult to trace, so it must be eliminated. Hence, the goal is to eliminate, ultimately do away with currency and to force every American into the computerized credit card system and banking system. If one questions a government official or a law enforcement officer about their hatred of cash or their heavy-handed seizure techniques, they will simply argue that cash is the mother's milk of drug traffickers and money launderers, and therefore, if we want to stop drugs, we must make a small sacrifice and stop cash. But the small sacrifice means sacrificing the U.S. Constitution and all of your basic rights. Okay, let's look at the money laundering laws. In the former Soviet Union, if the government wanted to apprehend and imprison someone who had committed no crime, they charged him with the catch-all crime of hooliganism, they call it. Hooliganism, and they could throw anybody in jail on hooliganism. Okay? The American equivalent of hooliganism is the catch-all RICO or conspiracy statutes originally created to arrest and jail organized crime figures. In recent years, the government has created a new catch-all crime punishable by imprisonment, confiscation of property, heavy fines, etc. It is called money laundering. Okay? Most Americans suppose that money laundering refers primarily to the hidden laundered movement of cash profits from drug sales. Wrong. It refers to almost any financial crime, broken financial regulation, the use of cash, avoidance of government cash reporting laws, unreported foreign bank accounts, unreported transfers of funds, are virtually anything the government bureaucrats want it to mean. The definition is intentionally vague and ever-expanding. A money laundering crime can be anything they want it to be that is related to money. IRS agents are greatly accelerating money laundering cases in situations where there is obviously no criminal intent and certainly no involvement whatsoever with drugs or drug money. Remember, the IRS considers money laundering to be any effort you make to disguise your assets or to avoid completing a federal currency transaction report or border crossing report. Let me show you what the federal currency transaction report is. This is a form 8300, okay? They fill these out on you in a bank. If you go in and do any kind of a transaction in a bank of $10,000 or more in cash or cashier's checks or postal money orders or traveler's checks, and then, by the way, they now consider cashier's checks, postal money orders, traveler's checks and so forth to be cash. You do a transaction of $10,000, they fill out one of these little forms on you. It's a form 8300. It goes to the IRS. Now, it's not the end of the world if they fill out that form on you. They're sitting on 35 million of these forms, and they really don't quite have the manpower and the technology quite yet to process them, so an awful lot of them get filed. And in fact, some drug dealers actually go out and do drug deals, and they have these forms filled out on them when they do their banking, and they figure they'll just be lost in the shuffle. But if you look suspicious, or you look cross-eyed, or you protest about having that form filled out on you, and in a lot of instances they fill them out, and they have to. If the banker doesn't fill one out, and he's done a $10,000 transaction with you, he can go to jail for 10 years and a $250,000 fine. They are filling them out. They're not allowed to tell you that they are filling them out, okay? They're also guilty of a crime if they do that. But if they check this little box up here in the right-hand corner that says suspicious transaction, you've got a problem. You'll probably have a visit from a couple of unfriendly agents within about a week. They'll be from the Criminal Investigating Division of the IRS, and they'll definitely begin to grill you, audit you, or whatever. So those are being filled out. Now, but it is a crime to try to avoid having this filled out. And you have to understand, if you go to great lengths to avoid having this filled out, you can go to jail for up to 20 years and a $500,000 fine. Does that begin to give you the impression that they're real serious about trying to drive us away from cash? Because they don't really sentence most people for bank robbery or murder to 20 years in jail or a $500,000 fine. So you see, these cash reporting laws are now more severe than almost any other kind of laws we've got. Okay, the government is growing, government's growing, expanding money laundering laws are becoming the basis for a total financial dictatorship in America, all under the guise of fighting the drug war. Okay, the first thing the Nazis did in the 1930s to establish control over their people was to establish money crimes that were punishable by asset or property confiscation and imprisonment. Half a century later, the same thing is happening here. The war on drugs and cash is a classic government power grab. The Treasury Department has issued a booklet entitled Money Laundering, A Banker's Guide to Avoiding Problems, which contains a list of suspicious activities that the Treasury Department says fit the profile of a money launderer. Now, let's see if any of you have ever done any of those suspicious activities and fit the profile. Here's what they say the bankers are supposed to look for. Paying off a delinquent loan all at once. My, my, that's very suspicious. Changing currency from small to large denominations. Buying cashier's checks, money orders, or traveler's checks, all now defined as cash, for less than the reporting unit, which is under $10,000. Okay? Acting nervous while making large transactions with cash or monetary instruments. God help you if you just had a fight with your wife, if you've got the flu, if you're feeling bad and you act nervous because they can fill out one of these forms on you. See, this is what they did in the Eastern European countries, where everybody began to spy on everybody else. And by the way, if a banker or someone turns you in for suspicious behavior and the government confiscates any of your funds, they'll get between a 10 and 25% finder's fee for having turned you in. Okay, opening an account and using it as a collateral for a loan. Presenting a transaction that involves a large number of $1,500 bills. Presenting a transaction without counting the cash first. All of these are considered to be suspicious behavior and can get that little box checked. Okay? Murder, rape, and armed robbery now result in smaller and less frequent jail terms or fines than the new federal crime of money laundering. In fact, the penalties for money laundering are 10 times more severe than the crimes prosecuted as tax evasion. Now, structuring laws are also important that you understand and that you not violate these. And I want to make it very clear, I'm encouraging you do not violate these laws. They are jailing thousands and thousands of your fellow citizens who didn't understand these laws. And I can assure you, ignorance of the law makes absolutely no difference to these folks. Structuring is defined by the IRS as any effort to avoid reporting transaction or reporting cash or other monetary transactions over $10,000 by breaking them down into smaller related transactions over any 12-month period. Monetary instruments include structuring are included in structuring are cash, cashier's checks, money orders, and traveler's checks. If you go out in any 12-month period and you pull cash out of your bank $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 at a time, and it totals over $10,000, then they can accuse you of structuring, and the maximum penalty is 20 years in jail and a $500,000 fine. Structuring is now defined as money laundering and as a criminal offense punishable with up to a 20-year jail sentence and a $500,000 fine per violation. This is Nazi Germany all over. This is what they were doing in Germany 50 years ago or 60 years ago. It is against the law for a bank or merchant to tell you that you might be violating the law. This can get him prosecuted as part of your structuring conspiracy. If they think your behavior is suspicious, they must fill out a form on you without telling you and file it with the IRS, who will promptly audit you or begin a criminal investigation. The IRS admits that 85% of the people accused of structuring committed no other crime than seeking to protect their privacy. The courts have upheld numerous criminal structuring convictions for violations that concealed no criminal activity. If the government wins the conviction, The judge must sentence the criminal to a mandatory prison sentence. All structuring violations now call for a, if you're convicted, they call for mandatory prison sentences. Okay? This gives lie to the argument that money laundering structuring laws were enforced to get drug dealers and fight the war on drugs. The fact is, it is easier to convict an honest law-abiding citizen and confiscate his property than to go after a real drug dealer who has a battery of high-priced lawyers and accountants and who might even shoot back. Okay? Conclusion, money laundering and structuring laws have little to do with the war on drugs. That's simply the excuse. They are a legal way for the socialist government bureaucrats to plunder and confiscate people's assets, as in Nazi Germany or Russia. They are a way to enrich the government's debt-ridden coffers. They are a way to move us toward a cashless society, and they are a way to place Orwellian-type controls on the American people. Now, let's look and see what they're doing in the area of asset forfeiture. This is how the government is using asset forfeiture to plunder the people via seizure laws. Now, you have to understand, as the government comes in and seizes people's assets, everything they're doing is legal. They can tell you that it's legal, and they've got some laws, rules, or regulations that they've passed in recent years. They're unconstitutional, but ignore the Constitution, they do. We shouldn't ignore it, but they do. But these laws, rules, and regulations are being passed, and so what they are doing under law, okay? And they would say they're perfectly within the law. They're just enforcing the law. Starting about 1984, there were a whole bunch of seizure forfeiture laws which were passed. And these keep growing, and they keep adding more and more teeth to them. George Orwell's 1984 has arrived in the USSA. Just as in Nazi Germany in the 1930s and in Russia from 1917 to 1990, any government agent or agency in America today can seize almost any property from any American, and there is very little the citizen can do to protect himself. We are witnessing the death of property rights in America. Human rights and all other freedoms are likely to follow. In 1984, government seizures of so-called illegal assets totaled $30 million. In 1991, they exceeded $644 million. In 1992, seizures exceeded $800 million. Since 1985, the Government Asset Forfeiture Office boasts that over $2.5 billion and U.S. citizens' assets have been seized. Over 80% of these seizures never resulted in an arrest or a conviction, indicating that most are being taken from innocent people. Okay, according to USA Today, there are now 1,000 forfeitures per week in the United States, or about 52,000 per year. 52,000 of your fellow citizens are having their assets seized from them by the government for violation of one of these new criminalized rules and regulations. Okay, 52,000. Just want you to get the point. These are not isolated examples. Assets seized in order of frequency are cash and other monetary instruments, vehicles, boats, planes, banks and brokerage accounts, real estate, especially homes, and pension and profit sharing plans. Okay? Asset forfeiture is an unconstitutional process, though considered legal according to new socialist laws and regulations, which allows the government or any police agency to simply accuse or suspect you of a crime, but not formally charge you, and then seize your property. Okay? In most instances, there is no arrest, no trial, and no conviction. You are presumed guilty until you can prove your innocence, and that's exactly the opposite of what the Constitution said. Okay? The great majority of the people who have had their property seized from them by the police are innocent and law-abiding. One citizen showed that 80% of the seizures, then the police never even filed charges against the victims of the seizures, or in some cases they filed charges and then dropped them. The police need no warrant to seize your property. With no due process, they don't even have to formally charge you with a crime. There are hundreds of local and state federal laws and thousands of regulations on the books under which the government can seize your property. Under these forfeiture seizure laws, and they're seizing most of this property under civil law. Very important. If they accuse you of a crime, if they accuse you of a criminal crime, okay, then they have to prove that you're guilty in a court of law, and you've got a trial by jury. But if they do it under civil forfeiture laws, they don't have to accuse you. They don't even have to arrest you. They don't have to charge you with the crime. All they have to do, you have to prove that you didn't do something wrong, and that's very expensive, especially if they've seized all your assets and you can't even afford to hire an attorney. Okay? So under these seizure forfeiture laws, the government or police can seize your property worth 100 or even 1,000 times the value of the maximum fine or the alleged offense, and they don't even need to convict you to do it. Okay? These seizures are legalized theft by those who are supposed to be upholding the law and give you a hint at the mindset of government agents, bureaucrats, and the police today. Justice is out, plunder is in. The government and the police do not have to show any more than probable cause that a crime has been committed, the same standard which for centuries has been applied to search warrants. So the police can now seize your home with no more evidence than it once took to search it. Okay? Probable cause can be when a government suspects. All they have to do is suspect racketeering, which can mean almost anything. They can suspect drug possession, suspect drug trafficking, money laundering, robbery, murder, tax evasion, extortion, environmental crimes, violation of the Trading with the Enemies Act, violation of the Emergency Economic Powers Act. They can suspect gun control violations, and they can attack you as they just did down in Waco. They had no proof that those people were doing anything wrong, but they attacked and went in with guns blazing, stun grenades, et cetera, et cetera. More than 100 suspected unlawful activities named in the legislation, those make up practical probable cause, so if they just think that you might be doing something wrong, they can invade your home and grab what they see. Okay, finder's fees of 10 to 25% of the value of the assets seized are regularly paid out to informants. USA Today has said that in 1992, 65 informants made over $100,000 each by simply alleging to police agency that friends, neighbors, and or business associates had committed crimes. And when you go to trial, you don't have the right to confront the informant in court. The reason is it's a civil, not a criminal proceeding. According to the Pittsburgh Press, over 80% of the victims of 25,000 seizures they analyzed were never accused of any crime. This is simply legalized theft or plunder. How is this different from Nazi Germany? Looking suspicious can get your assets seized. A suspicious customer or transaction as a bank or financial institution goes to the top of the seizure list. I showed you the box at the time at the top of the cash reporting report. And if you protest having that form filled out, or make a fuss about it, or whatever, the box may be checked, and the bank is not allowed to tell you that they are filling out the form or checking that particular box. That is a no-no. They're supposed to notify the Treasury Department. They can't tell you. They're just supposed to spy. Okay? Should the Treasury Department find your action suspicious, it can freeze your assets, and it's up to you to prove that the seizure is improper. Burden of proof on you. But what if they froze all your assets and you can't get them out? I had a friend who was in the securities business over in Denver, Colorado. This man was honest. He had broken no laws. He employed 40 people in a securities firm. And he had about $50 million in real estate partnerships. This happened 2 years ago. Okay? He fired an employee for doing some wrong things. The employee went to the local sheriff's office and said, these people are guilty of all kinds of criminal fraud. Let me tell you how they conducted the investigation of this guy's firm. They called the television cameras and said, we are going to have a giant bust of this firm. They had about all three of the local stations had their TV cameras there. About six police cars, county sheriff's cars, pulled up with about 30 uniformed police. I think some of them were in black ninja suits. They jump out. They run up into the offices. They grabbed all of this man's records, all of his records, computer records, hard copy, et cetera, et cetera. They hauled them all out. They instantly froze all of his bank accounts. Of course, it made the 6 o'clock news, so they ruined his reputation because they said this is a criminal investigation of the securities firm for criminal fraud, et cetera, et cetera. And they can destroy you by simply going into the press with that. Within 2 days, his credit lines were canceled by his banks. His assets were frozen. He couldn't even hire an attorney. He could not even hire an attorney because they'd frozen all of his money. He had to lay off his 40 employees on the fourth or fifth day of the siege. He couldn't even defend himself because they had all of his records. Ultimately, he had to take bankruptcy. He closed his firm. The $50 million in limited partnerships collapsed. And the people in the sheriff's department said, well, see, that proves it. Proves it was fraud. Look, they went under. Look, those people made that happen, okay? All of this was an investigation. And no charges were even filed against the man. That's the way they do it in the United States today. Okay? Forfeiture laws were expanded in 1984 to allow the government to seize assets without first charging the owner. The proceeds finance more investigations and are helping to finance the financial shortfall of local, state, and federal governments. Eliminating the need to prove a crime has moved most action to civil court, where the government accuses the item, not the owner, of being tainted by a crime, And as a result, jury trials can be refused, illegal searches condoned, and rules of evidence ignored. In 80% of the seizure cases, no charges are filed. If they are filed, you have plenty of time to fight them. But when no charges are filed and the action is a civil seizure forfeiture, you only have a limited time to fight the seizure. In California, you only have 10 days, okay? To fight the seizure forfeitures, you have to post a bond of up to 10% of the value of the property and pay all court costs. This is often impossible if the government has seized or frozen your bank account, leaving you broke and unable to defend yourself, and that's what happened to my friend. The forfeiture hearings, there's no presumption of innocence. You are presumed guilty until you prove your innocence. In a criminal trial, you simply have to raise reasonable doubt as to your guilt. But in a police forfeiture hearing, you have a positive burden to prove your innocence. Okay, who profits from the assets seized? If an informant was involved, he's paid a 10 to 25% of the proceeds, tax-free. The balance is typically split 70% to the local police, the district attorney's office, judge's chambers, and the feds, splitting the rest. If it was a federal seizure, the feds will seize up to 70% of the proceeds. Okay, the transitional American concept or traditional American concept of the police and courts is that justice is meant to be impartial. We all recoil at the thought of the police prosecuting district attorneys or judges having a direct financial stake in the outcome of a case, yet this is exactly what's happening under these seizure laws. This is how the Mexican and other third world officials have been corrupted over the years and how they have stolen to enrich themselves. We are witnessing the Mexicanization of American justice. Okay, in conclusion, we're entering an unconstitutional socialist quagmire of seizures, forfeitures, and lawsuits of incredible proportions. The government encourages Americans to spy on one another for pay. The government and police unconstitutionally seize and confiscate private property of innocent American citizens as if we had no more property rights than the captive peoples in Russia, Red China, or Nazi Germany of the 1930s. Americans who believe in constitutional guarantees to privacy or simply the use of cash are treated like criminals, are impoverished, jailed, or both. A growing number of our police and government officials no longer necessarily represent justice and protection. I hope that's a minority, but unfortunately, whatever the number, it's growing, but are being corrupted by their newfound ability to share in the loot. Everyone is beginning to be suspicious of everyone else, and especially of the police and government officials, a growing number of whom are beginning to look and act more and more like their Gestapo and KGB counterparts every day. This is not the America we all grew up in. Welcome to the USSA, a branch of the New World Order. Now, a couple of very recent developments, which you need to know about. There is now legislation floating around in Washington. It's called Senate Bill 8, and it redefines political protest as terrorism. The socialist pattern for redefinition and expansion of crimes is kind of interesting. They come along and they take something like money laundering and they make it into a crime to get you if you use cash or privacy. They come along and they use child abuse as not getting your children inoculated or leaving your children at home alone or whatever, and so they make that a new crime. Well, they're doing the same thing with the crime of terrorism. Senate Bill 8 is called the Crime Control Bill of 1993. You write in your contact your congressman and your senator, and you lean on them hard to oppose that legislation. You tell them you'll oppose them in the next election. It is very, very dangerous bill. A pro-life demonstrator under this bill can be considered a terrorist activity, a pro-life demonstration. RICO racketeering statutes can be used against traditional political activity. More than one offense in 4 years qualifies as terrorism. So if you go out and demonstrate in front of an abortion clinic for a second time in a four-year period, then you can be accused of being a terrorist if this legislation goes through. Illegal searches, wiretaps, and seizures are now legal, but they're going to be expanded under this new crime control bill. As I've been talking about earlier, those powers will now be expanded. Penalties for violation of the Emergency Economic Powers Act are to be increased from $10,000 to $1 million. Okay? Security personnel at airports now must notify law enforcement agencies if a traveler is carrying over $10,000 in cash. Expanded criminal penalties for civil rights violations will include things like discrimination against a homosexual or other minority. That'll be part of this new crime control bill. And they are planning to set up forfeiture squads in rural areas, okay? So they know that there are a lot of people who have moved to the small towns or whatever, and so they're planning to try to accommodate them as well. Now, Hillary and her socialist comrades want your children. We need to remember that in Russia, China, Cuba, and communist countries, they always target the children. They always try to get the children, brainwash them, turn them away from their families, from belief in God, from traditional values, etc., etc. In China, they programmed the children to actually turn in their parents. Many children presided in and actually participated in the execution of their parents in China, and this is an old communist tactic. John Dewey is known as the father of American education, and John Dewey said a few years ago, he was a leading secular humanist, globalist, and he said, if we are going to destroy the influence of Christianity and the family on children in order to revolutionize our country, then we must get the children into school all day long, get them gone at 8 to 7 o'clock in the morning. They're there till 3 or 4 in the afternoon, put them into sports in the afternoons, keep them in homework all evening, and if the parents are lucky, they'll have 20, 30 minutes with their kids a day, and we will have control of their minds, and eventually we will break this horrible hold that the family and Christianity has on children in America. And that's what the U.S. Public education system is all about, okay? They've also been masterful in getting our children to watch television. Shame on you if you watch TV. You should not be watching television. They're brainwashing your children with secular humanist and globalist and promiscuous and pro-homosexual garbage. Turn off the television 100%. Read books. Play with your family. Do something. But stop watching your television, okay? Antonio Gramsci said it well. Change their culture, demoralize, degenerate their culture, and in a generation or so, it'll be an easy hop for us to come in and take power. Now, Bill and Hillary have entered the stage, and they want your kids. And they are creating a whole new infrastructure of laws and regulations dealing with child abuse. And in the near future, if you teach your children about homosexuality and what the Bible has to say about it, it could be criminal child abuse. It could be a hate crime. If you refuse to get your children inoculated, that could be considered to be child abuse. They're creating a whole new socialist structure around the plight of the child, and they're going to write tens of thousands of new regulations having to do with children, which just as they're controlling the environment and money, they're going to try to control the children, and basically it's called the takeover of the children. The socialist America envisions you're not being in control of your children. They want to be in control of your children. Now, they are pushing legislation. Teddy Kennedy has written it right now. Hillary is pushing it. Donna Shalala is pushing it for mandatory inoculation of your children. Okay? Mandatory inoculation. If you don't get your children inoculated from the day they're born forward with the government inoculations, you will be guilty of criminal child abuse. You can be jailed. You can have your children taken from you by the social services, and you can be fined or all of the above. That legislation is roaring through and is likely to be in place within 60 days. Okay? The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child says basically it's coming against for children's rights, against parents' rights. Children are against, according to the UN Convention and according to Mrs. Clinton, the children will have the rights to sue you in court. They do not have to listen to your authority. Spanking will certainly become considered a crime under the United Nations Conventions on the Rights of the Child, etc., etc. In short, they definitely want your children. Now, just a couple of quick words on Operation Waco. Operation Waco is a pretty scary thing because if they can get away with it there, they can get away with it anywhere. There are some people, some conservatives in Washington trying to build a case on this. They're producing films. The Gun Owners of America is trying to take a major position on what happened in Waco. But you know that you don't serve a warrant, an arrest warrant, or a search warrant by surrounding a building with 100 people and charging through the windows with helicopters, gunships overhead, et cetera, et cetera. That's not the way police operations are done. They could have sent a couple of deputy sheriffs or a couple of federal agents up there to serve a warrant. They had gotten in before. They said they had to do it because they couldn't get at Koresh. Koresh was out of the compound all the time. He jogged in the neighborhood. He went around the compound all the time. They wanted publicity for this raid. They called in the press a day or so before. They wanted to get publicity for it, and so they called in the press and they said, hey, there's going to be a big doings, okay? They wanted to haul out all these guns and these guys in handcuffs and use this as a big propaganda blitz against guns. Now, why did they plan the attack in the first place? Well, to accelerate the gun control juggernaut, to use this as an excuse to go after more guns, and they will go ahead and use it as an excuse, but also to attack religious groups. They have started now calling religious groups, Christian groups. I believe in the future they will probably label Mormons in this way, and a lot of different religious groups who don't go along with the mainstream as dangerous religious cults. And in the last 60 days, USA Today, New York Times has been telling us, how do you recognize members of dangerous religious cults? Well, they believe in the Bible. They go to Bible studies all the time. They believe in disciplining their children to the point of child abuse. And they use the excuse, spare the rod, spoil the child. They believe in Bible prophecy and the second coming of Christ and see significance in Jerusalem. They believe in homeschooling, and they believe in collecting guns and survival food and things like this, and know these people. Watch for these people. When you see people that have those characteristics, watch for them, because they represent dangerous cults, okay? And that's how they've begun to describe us in the wake of Operation Waco, and that describes most of the Christian people I know across this country. Okay? I'm running out of time, so I've got to speed up. I got about 2 or 3 minutes left. Basically, when they went in, they knew they were going to burn these people. They announced it to the burn units at the hospitals. There were warnings that there were going to be a lot of burn patients coming in 2 days before it happened. The gas that they pumped in is highly flammable. CS gas is not tear gas. It's 80 times stronger than tear gas. It immobilizes you. It was used as a battlefield immobilizing weapon in Vietnam. And when you pump it into a close headquarters, most police people and military people know that it will explode. It's very explosive. So apparently they wanted to burn the evidence and get rid of it. There needs to be a massive congressional investigation on this. It cannot be investigated and covered up by the Clinton administration or by Janet Reno, who, by the way, is now being described as a hero, a folk hero back in Washington. Read Time magazine, May 10. They describe her as a folk hero for having burned all those folks out. Okay? We need a congressional investigation on this, and you need to put pressure on your congressman to do so. I'm frustrated because I'm running out of time, so let me just simply close and say there's lots that you can do if you want to. We need to start taking a stand for our country. All that's necessary for evil to triumph, Edmund Burke said, is that good men do nothing. Good men and women have been doing nothing for a long time in this country, and evil is triumphing. There's a lot of physical preparations you can make. I think you should do so. I've talked about those the last couple days. Get this videotape, take it out and play it for your friends and so forth. There's a lot of financial preparations you can do. You can buy some gold and silver. You ought to do that. We can help you. Come out to our booth and see us. There are a lot of things you need to do as far as getting out of debt. I've tried to touch on those. You need to develop a mindset of survival, but the most important thing you need to do is you need to develop a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ like never before. I came to know him as my personal savior a few years ago, and frankly, I wouldn't be in this battle if he didn't give me the strength and the encouragement and so forth. And I have to read my Bible every day, and I go to the Psalms, and I go to the book of Isaiah, and I get a lot of encouragement from there. This is a spiritual battle, just as it was in Nazi Germany, and you can't just fight it on the political or the financial level. I would encourage you to find a personal relationship with the God of the Bible, with the Lord Jesus Christ. I would encourage you to be on your knees praying for our leaders every day. Yeah, that's right. Even pray for Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton that God would turn them around. Pray for the kinds of people who are speaking at this meeting. Look, we need to have a spiritual revival in this country, and if we do, I believe God will intervene. I just want to close with one Bible verse that says in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their evil or wicked ways, then I will repent and I will heal their land. We need God to heal our land. Seek God and ask him, how then shall you live as the foundations are crumbling? I appreciate your time today. We've got a lot of this in our newsletters. I would encourage you to subscribe to my newsletter. We'll give you a 30% discount if you'll take it while you're here. I would strongly encourage you to get my newsletter. You can Xerox it for your friends. I would strongly encourage you to buy the videotapes from this conference. The other guys, Jack McLam and Lindsay and Bose and the other videotapes, and circulate these and play these for your friends. I would encourage you to get involved in the political battle for our freedom. Get angry at what they're trying to do to take our freedom. But first and foremost, you seek God and ask him, how should you live? We need to have a sense of urgency about serving our Lord Jesus Christ, and we need to have a sense of urgency about taking a stand against evil. My God is still in control, and with him on our side, we will win. Thank you very much, and God bless you.